Programming Conference 2021. Nice to meet you here. Thank you for your interest in my quick video on my paper titled Did J. Hotraw Respect the Law of Good Style? A Deep Dive into the Nature of False Positives of Bad Code Smells. My name is Daniel Speicher. The paper is the result of research I did under the supervision of Professor Dr. Armin Bekremers at the University of Bonn. I'm currently working at the Cron GmbH in Bonn, a company with excellent software engineering standards, including code quality. In the next minutes, I'd like to introduce the core concepts of the paper and the addressed research questions, sketch the study design, and give a teaser of the results and insights. Before I start, let me mention a deeper, somewhat more hidden motivation behind the research on false positives of bad code smells. I hope that it helps us a few steps forward on the question what the human mind sees in the code that might be missed by an analysis. Let's start with the core concepts and work towards the research question. Developers need to make a constant effort to improve the quality of their software if they want to stay productive. Luckily, there are many books that offer advice. Some even develop suggestions how to create tools offering automated advice. Let us open the book in the middle, discuss an example presented on page 17, and shortly after that have a look at the code that comes with the book and be surprised. The book in the middle is Growing Object-Oriented Software Guided by Tests by Steve Freeman and Ned Price, published in 2009. On page 17, they show us a bit of code that asks for improvement. The two lines are not easy to understand. The chain of getters seems to burden us with insights into the inner structure of these objects, and there's implicitly coupling to all these types we pass on our way into the inner structure. We should refactor this code. It asks, improve the internal design without changing its observable behavior. The authors write that once they realized that the code was meant to allow the saving of customizations, they pushed all the code into one method called allow saving of customizations. The call of this method tells the object main what to do instead of asking for its internals. The code follows the principle of tell don't ask. The simple line clearly communicates its intention. Everything is encapsulated and we have no unnecessary coupling. Going back to the previous state, could we describe a somewhat general structure that asks for refactoring? The different names for code structures asking for improvement, we stick with Kent Beck's term bad smell and use a color indicating the origin of the term coined by the then new father. We take three formulations of a bad smell from page 17 of the book. First, a violation of the tell don't ask principle. Second, train wrecks, it is an invocation chain accessing the internals of the objects. Third, violations of the soon-to-be-presented law of Demeter. Could a tool detect these smells? We are optimistic for the latter two. It would be nice for the aspiring developer to get pointed to these improvement opportunities, and the more senior developer might be happy every now and then to get reminded of such opportunities. Let us quickly consider an alternative change. Extract all the implicitly accessed objects into local variables. We see that the code does not improve. We might understand a bit more, but only by getting to know all the types that are not important to us. The overall intention is as unclear as before. The coupling is the same, and the encapsulation is now even visibly broken. So just removing the invocation chain is no improvement. It might be more helpful to get a rule that tells us which types we may access. The so-called law of Demeter does exactly this. Often paraphrased as only talk to friends, it limits the types a method is allowed to access to friend types and its supertypes. A friend type of a method M in a class C is the enclosing class C itself, types of its fields, types of the method's parameters, and types instantiated in the method. This check looks easy to implement and detectors to find violations have been implemented often. After checking that our implementation of the law of Demeter would actually find the bad code from page 17, we might want to exercise it on other code bases. Why not on the code base that comes with the book Growing Object-Oriented Software Guided by Tests? The book develops Auction Sniper, a tool to make effective use of online auctions. The test below expresses the expectation that a sniper listener gets informed about a lost auction if the auction closes immediately after it started. But don't we see an invocation chain right in the middle of this code? Well, yes, but is it actually a train wreck? Maybe, but rather not. However, our newly created detector for law of Demeter violations tells us that the return type of at least is not a friend type, rendering the call to off in violation of the law of Demeter. What now? Plausible rule tells us that the code created to exemplify good software development practices needs to be improved. The line under consideration is written in a special coding style. If we have never seen this style, we might feel confused and indecisive. If we are already familiar with this style, our gut feeling probably tells us that the rule is very wrong here, maybe even everywhere. To bring us into the position to support gut feeling by a systematic assessment, let me say a few words on the coding style. The line under consideration used the mocking framework JMOC. The framework offers a fluent API or a fluent interface. The idea of a fluent interface has long been used, but was explicitly described by Martin Fowler in 2005. There is even an Uppsala paper backing JMOC, and the framework is still actively maintained. We see here a subset of JMOC's fluent API. The interface is defined in such a clever way that method chaining, supported by the IDE's code completion, guides you through this creation of a sentence expressing your expectations. The type structure defines a grammar for your sentences. In the presented subset, methods in cardinality clause, like at least, have the return type receiver clause, so if you want to continue, you have to call off. Here only returning a method clause, so that you have to continue with method. Our example is debating here already, but the relevant idea becomes clear if we stick here with the subset. A fluent API is created for ease of writing and intuitive readability, and it is readable as long as you don't worry about the shrewd object structure that is required to make it work. Actually, you have already seen too much. You shouldn't need to worry about types like receiver clause. Back to the line of code under consideration. The law of Demeter says we should not code like this. The fluent API of JMOC says, I want you to code exactly this way. Who wins? If recency decided, the fluent API would win. If the number of published papers decided, the law of Demeter would win. There's at least one case study that found some correlation between law of Demeter violations and the number of bugs. We could try to get a majority vote from randomly selected developers, or we could just think. Think with an open but disciplined mind. The papers on the law of Demeter describe its expected benefits and lists refactorings to let the code fulfill the law. Let us discuss the given code from these two perspectives. Following the law should reduce coupling, improve understandability, and protect encapsulation. While we easily applied these criteria before, they are difficult to apply here. The Fluent API was explicitly offered to support readability. Types are not meant to be considered and are all placed together in one package, so that the coupling might be negligible. Furthermore, the Fluent API doesn't tell us anything about the underlying objects, thus encapsulation is not broken. May I refer you for the details of the two recommended refactorings to the paper? They are not too tricky, but not easy to illustrate in the given case. Both would, like we saw in the introductory example, reduce the number of method invocations, the coding style of choice of a fluent API. To summarize, the quality issues addressed by the law of Demeter are no issue here, the refactorings are no option, we should keep the code as it is. We don't want to change the code. We don't want to consider the law of Demeter violation a quality issue here. There's no question that the occurrence of the law is a true positive in the sense of formal correctness, but it is a false positive in the sense of pragmatic validity. So we stumbled upon a false positive of a bad smell, found a substantial design idea there, and discussed the relation between the bad smell and the design idea. Next, we will finally ask how to incorporate the design idea into the smell so that we don't get habituated to the smell warnings through irrelevant false positives, barring the relevant true positives. We will look out for similar cases and ask for the nature of discovered design ideas, the relation between smell and design idea, and finally comment on consequences for the definition of both. How to adapt the law of Demeter to fluent APIs? A fluent API uses the types in a very unique way. It seems to have its own quality criteria. Consequently, it would be very reasonable to just state that the law of Demeter doesn't apply to fluent APIs. But if we want, we can integrate the design idea more seamlessly into the law of Demeter definition by either just considering any type that is part of a fluent API to be everybody's friend type, or we consider them only to be friend types where they are used as intended. The arguments we present before are inherent to the idea of a fluent API, so that we happily want to exclude all the accesses to a fluent API from the law. Doing so removes annoying warnings without having to abandon the law completely. Let us now quickly sketch the design of our exploratory case study. We confronted Jehotra with the law of Demeter and discussed the potential violations thoroughly. We hope to find many false positives for our code smell so that we are able to review them with respect to our research questions. Question 1. What is the nature of design ideas that conflict with bad smell definitions? Question 2. How can a design idea turn a potential bad smell into a false positive? Question 3. What are the consequences for the definition of bad smells and design ideas? Hoping that it's full of general and maybe even specific design ideas, we have chosen a software to analyze the framework JHotDraw. It is a classical framework for the creation of interactive drawing applications. For a few more remarks on its history, I'd like to point you to the paper. You will recognize a few of its contributors. A JHotDraw application consists of the drawing window containing a drawing view. The model of the application is the drawing consisting of figures. Figures may have handles to manipulate them. Further tools allow for the creation, manipulation, and deletion of figures. And there are commands reachable from the menu. How can we still find bad smells in such a thoughtfully designed software? We take the rather rigid classical law of Demeter. The first publication, probably just joyfully playing with words, claimed to present an objective sense of style. Others, like Martin Fowler, would rather see this claim of objectivity moderated. To give some structure, depth, and reliability to our discussions, we use a checklist for the evaluation of the potential violations of the law. We check how the three qualities, coupling, understandability, and encapsulation, are affected and review how helpful the suggested refactorings may be. We stay open to discovering further criteria if the case under consideration suggests so. Depending on this discussion, we decide whether the code should be refactored or should rather stay as it is. For true positives, we just have to name the refactoring we want to apply and the number of similar cases that can be resolved in the same way. For false positives, we look out for a relevant design idea, make a suggestion how to adapt the smell, comment how easy the design idea may be localized, state our confidence in the adaptation, and count the number of similar cases. Let me now give a quick teaser on the results and insights. In total, 1,215 potential violations were found. The discussions are for a larger part in the appendix of the paper, as they amount in total to 50 pages. Detailed material ready to be analyzed in future research. The combination of JHotDraw and the law of Demeter indeed led to many false positives. At most, 42 of the 1,215 potential violations turned out to be true positives. Here are four preliminary categories for the design ideas we found, together with the number of false positives that can be resolved by adopting the law. In 472 cases, it was helpful to take the Java constructs like public static members into account. If we take further Java constructs like the type of constructor parameters into account, further 149 cases can be resolved. Allowing access to data classes would on its own resolve 540 cases. Creational design patterns play a role as well. And finally, respecting reasonable design decisions within JHotDraw allowed to eliminate further 53 cases. We got the many false positives we wanted to find to have something to dissect. The precision of the unadapted law is thus only 3.5%, but already taking general design ideas into account, we can improve the precision to 44.2%. Nevertheless, being confronted with 52 false positives on a daily basis is not acceptable, and with enough perseverance, we were able to adapt the law to the given case to reach 100% precision. What are the deeper insights? Let me mention four. First, the smell was incomplete, not in a formal way. Outer classes of anonymous inner classes have not been considered and are thus no friend types. But with respect to the intention of the original authors, they surely did not want to cast a judgment about these Java-specific cases. As other research had already shown, developers make design trade-offs and often a design idea wins over a smell. In our case, just allowing access to fields of a rectangle eliminates 366 false positives. Most interestingly, we had to take design ideas that are specific to JHotDraw into account. Allowing access to selected figures and the drawing through the drawing view brings some helpful orthogonality to the design. Third, another, to the best of our knowledge, new finding is the necessity to interpret terms of a smell, even of a smell as clearly defined as the law of Demeter. Object instantiation must cover as well creational design patterns. Fourth, finally, not only the law must be interpreted, but it's helpful to interpret the code to the law, mainly by making types accessible to the law that otherwise would be ignored. The findings give rise to quite some adaptations of the law, but once understood, they are straightforward to make. Some types and members should just be considered everybody's friend and to be accessible from everywhere. Some adaptations should be more tailored. The drawing and the figure become your friend if you are friends with the drawing view. Anonymous inner classes share the friends of its outer classes. Downcasts on parameters should be considered, giving the real type of the parameter. Finally, calls to creational design patterns should be considered to be like instantiations. After shoving the false positives to the side, there are a few but substantial findings that were hidden under the pile of false positives. A few cases can be easily refactored using the suggested refactorings. A few more cases can be resolved by making type information more explicit. Finally, there's one central issue that cannot be resolved ad hoc. The central drawing editor is meant to be a mediator and thus to decouple the colleague's drawing view, drawing and tool. Its interface gives, contrary to this intention, access to these colleagues, inviting coupling. The design of JHotDraw was broadly as excellent as expected. In the end, the law of Demeter was nevertheless able to point out improvement opportunities. The paper and the data is available online. I hope the paper paves the way to adaptable and then precise bad smell definitions. Even if we don't want to make the step towards adaptability, the paper illustrates reasons for false positives and sheds light on design ideas. Thank you for watching. I look forward to our discussions.